The rat race of life can get exhausting for many, and saying goodbye to the struggles of work when the time comes is often seen as a sigh of relief. For those who have prepared for retirement properly, that is. Are you taking the proper steps to putting away money for life after work? We'll be discussing all about retirement in today's episode. I'm Edric Mendoza, and you're watching On The Money.
I am about to retire from my job, and this has kept me worried for some time now. While I will be receiving a retirement package from my employer and my SSS pension benefits, I still feel that the money would not be enough to sustain me through my so-called golden years. Do I still have time to boost my retirement savings? What can I do now to supplement the money I will be receiving from my employer and SSS by the time I retire?
It is never too late to save up for retirement. To help us with the topic, we have SunLife AIM financial planner, Early de Guzman. Thank you for taking time to be with us today,
Thank you.
Thank you. Early. Thank you for the invite.
Yeah, welcome. Let's talk about retirement. Do you think that if a person is 50 years old and up, mm-hmm. it is too late for them to retire?
Never too late.
Or to save up for retirement, at least.
Never too mm-hmm. late to save.
Okay.
One must save, period.
Sure.
Any age and all ages.
Okay.
And more importantly, the older you are, of course, mm-hmm. the more important it is you get to it.
Sure.
50, though, is not that old mm-hmm. nowadays. Mm-hmm. And I suppose the regular retirement age is anywhere of 60 or 65.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. So why do you say that it's not too late?
Because there are so many avenues right now to be able to make your assets grow, mm-hmm. to make your money mm-hmm. earn more. We are in a very progressive age that was not there 20, 30 years ago.
Okay, so can you give specifics? So there's about a 10 to 15 year window if you're 50.
Well, if
right.
we're estimating, as they say now, the lifespan's about mm-hmm. 85 right now. So mm-hmm. that means if you retire at 65, you have to program for a 20-year
sure.
lifestyle.
Sure.
And so what do we have right now? Well, you have from, of course, the regular bank deposits. You have your mutual funds on the other extreme. Mm-hmm. And you have the stock market. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, between that, you have your other options mm-hmm. like businesses or mm-hmm. Creating asset-producing income for you,
sure.
your passive income stream.
And all of these options are available to someone who is in this situation. I'm 50.
Yes.
I have
to anyone.
10 to 15
That's
years
right.
to prepare, yeah?
Yes, there
okay.
is. Okay.
How would you mix and match those options for someone who is in that situation?
Well, the older you are, of course, the more you need to stay liquid.
Okay.
Especially if you've not prepared for the contingencies of life, like
point.
Critical illness mm-hmm. or sudden death mm-hmm. or, as we were talking earlier, mm-hmm. living too long.
Sure.
Now, having done that, if you have, you know, created a, maybe let's say a nest egg or your liquid or emergency fund, then you have surplus, which you can now invest. And that's where it becomes more exciting mm-hmm. because you have probably more time to think about this mm-hmm. than when you were growing up, and you probably have more funds to work with.
Mm-hmm. So even at the 50 stage, if a person doesn't have an emergency fund yet, you're saying step one for them is to now create this fund.
Well, let's assess where they're at,
okay?
And it's important to begin with, mm-hmm. to protect the most important income-generating asset they've got, which
sure.
is themselves.
Makes sense.
So if they haven't, you know, protected by getting insurance and then getting probably some health insurance mm-hmm. for a contingency that would be hard to bear mm-hmm. if you're already on a final stage of mm-hmm. your earning life, mm-hmm. then that's something they must mm-hmm. address. What age you start the
yeah.
insurance plan will be the premium that
right.
you will carry for life. So the older you start it, the
sure.
more expensive it will become because
okay.
the risk of insuring your life
clearly.
Will be higher.
Clearly.
So it's well-placed advice to start on as early as you can.
Okay.
But 50, very doable. The only problem with getting older is, will you be approved for insurance because of your mm-hmm. health condition?
At that state.
You're looking at medical history of the family. Mm-hmm. You're looking at, of course, even their paying capacity
mm-hmm. okay.
to maintain the plan.
Great, wonderful. So mm-hmm. we're talking about retirement 50s and up,
yes.
what to do for a person who is not ready.
Mm-hmm.
And you've already said said, making sure that they prepare the fund.
Yes, there's an emergency fund.
Cover themselves. What else?
They cover themselves, and the idea there is okay. Looking at an emergency fund, whereas before, in your younger years, maybe 3 to 6 months would be fine. You're probably looking at about 6 months to about a year. So that you feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. Now, anything beyond that is what you'd look at investing. Mm-hmm. Okay, beautiful in the market now is that investments can even take a combination of protection and investment. Mm-hmm. Now, mutual funds takes away now the aspect of medical underwriting for insurance. It's just a pure investment product. Mm-hmm. It's an in and out. What's beautiful, I think, about it is that if you want to sell your stock, you can be assured there's a buyer. And unlike a little bit with the stock market, you have to position for the price you want, unless you're just giving them a carte blanche, sell at whatever, right?
Of course.
Okay, then you have the UITFs of the banks, which is a pooled fund that they offer, similar to the mutual funds in mutual fund companies.
Okay. Now, if you were to advise people in their 50s between those options, to be able for them to have, like we said earlier, you have a 10 to 15 year window to save up so that you will have a nest egg in retirement at 60 or 65. Mutual funds, UITFs, which of those makes more sense and which of the tiers? Because there is a equity fund under mutual fund.
It really depends though on the investment risk appetite of the person. Mm-hmm. If it's a person who has retired with a very large severance pay or retirement package, then they can comfortably look at putting more in the riskier investments like equities or even balanced fund. But if you are left with this is all I've got and it's just barely what the law provides and this is all you've got, even probably risking in bonds and even GS stock, government securities or money market would probably be the way to go. And instead of a bank, although you need to put in the bank because that's your draw money when you need.
So you're saying even if they have that limited window, it's still safe to go in the aggressive areas regardless of their... I think my question was more on the lines of can a person even, or should a person even look at their risk appetite at that stage, assuming
they did not have
a retirement plan to begin with and they have very limited time left, then there really seems to be very few options as far as the range of assets would be. I cannot be as aggressive.
Not anymore,
example, right?
Yes, because that's all you've got.
Correct.
So if we were narrowing the question to something like, maybe medium, not a high net worth type of person.
Correct, okay. Because otherwise then they don't even need to plan for their time because they have it all covered.
Maybe not. We don't know if they're heavily exposed. There's so much debt. You have families to protect, and shares to cover and all that. But going back to the to that regular guy, if we're looking at how they can invest, all right? Well, first is to create that protection money. Then you have your income stream, and then you have the ones for critical illness or contingencies or lifestyle choices.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Now, looking at that, it would not be fair also, I think, to the person right now, given our economy, not to be invested in that type of fund, the higher yielding funds, balanced.
So still.
Yes, because that's where you get better than, what does the bank have now? Less than 1%.
Yeah.
Take it away. 0.25. No, some naman are 0.4, 0.5, you have a 0.7. If you're in time deposit, 1 or 2%. But you have withholding tax. So take 20% away from that. It's not very interesting money. Now, you look at time deposits, same, UITFs and mutual funds would probably come in, but these two are open to estate tax. And you don't have the kicker of that you have in a VUL fund where if something happens to you, you don't only get what your fund has grown into or the fund value, but you get the coverage
insurance,
that you got
life
there.
Insurance
yes.
Portion. Okay.
That's the difference there.
Okay, right. So there's actually a lot more details we can actually flesh out here. But let's go to a scenario instead where, so a person now has set a target, right, for retirement, and they're at the retirement age.
I think maybe the advocacy there is for people to face that question and answer it. At least if you have a target fund, then it's easier for financial planners and advisors like
sense.
Me to make sense of all you've got right now.
And it has. And
they must do that. It's something they must face. Mm-hmm. If not, you might be so heavily invested, for example, in real estate. I mean, I hear people buying condominiums left and right. I had a friend who bought 25 condominiums by the time he retired as treasury mm-hmm. head of a very big company, one of the top five here. Mm-hmm. After 5 years, I said, oh, so you're enjoying all this money? No, I sold them. It's such a headache, mm-hmm. you know, when a tenant complains about plumbing, et cetera, et cetera. So probably it's not property. Mm-hmm. Or look at the money you tie when you buy, mm-hmm. tie in or tie up. Mm-hmm. When you buy property, 5, 6 million, 20 million, 30 million, mm-hmm. and then your rental is just 6% of that.
Makes sense.
Compared to mm-hmm. mutual funds, in our case, for the last 10 years, our balance fund has been doing 13.6%, mm-hmm. not counting how this year will turn out.
Okay, right, go. So set the target. Now, the question I was asking was, mm-hmm. if a person hits that point and they don't hit their target, what advice do you give?
Okay, if you've not hit your target, mm-hmm. okay, first thing is to examine if that target is still reasonable at that point. Because if you let, there's only
things
one
change.
Way.
Yeah, life
things change.
Mm-hmm.
And very simple. The only way to address that is to increase income or input or asset or to decrease your spending or your costs. Mm-hmm. And so once you've arrived at reviewing how feasible, viable, how reasonable the target mm-hmm. is, then we start assessing our assets. Mm-hmm. Which ones can we position so that it's higher yielding? Mm-hmm. Which ones can we liquefy,
right.
you know, so that you have money to play
sure.
or create mm-hmm. purchases that can bring in better mm-hmm. yields.
And biting the bullet, I think, part of that. I mean, if
yeah.
you don't, right?
To begin
it's
with.
Part of the reality, yeah. yeah.
Whether okay. you like it or not, you'll have
yeah.
to.
Like yeah. I said, there's so many things we want to discuss with you. Mm-hmm. We're going to pause for a short break at this point. Stay tuned. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On the Money. Let's check what Salve Duplito has for us. And Salve says,
be careful of the financial advice that you get from other people. Take this viewer as an example. She asks, dear Salve, our family of three has been renting a 30 square meter apartment in Makati, allowing us to spend only 16 pesos per day for transportation. Our situation enables us to put 10,000 a month on a college fund, 5,000 a month on a house or car fund, 5,000 a month for our annual insurance premiums, 2,000 a month for our retirement, and save 60,000 per year to increase our emergency fund. Our parents and other relatives insist we buy a house, but buying will probably wipe out our emergency fund and force us to pay at least 15,000 to 25,000 per month in amortization. We would have to cut back on any of our investments, not to mention increased transportation costs. People have been telling us that we're throwing away money on rent. We tried to do the math and it comes down to a choice between spending most of our savings on a house payment or keep on renting but fund emergency, college, retirement, and house or car funds. What should I do? Diana. Now, Diana, you did your math well, and I agree with you wholeheartedly. That's why you need to keep your eyes focused despite the pressure, because you are on the right track. This is what I've been telling people for the longest time. Never buy a house at the expense of your emergency fund and other savings goals, especially health, education, and retirement. Of course, a house is a good investment, but can you eat it when you retire? Can it make you get well when you get sick? Of course you can sell it, but where will you stay at the time you need the comfort of your own home? Your way is so much better. Invest so that you have cash to buy your home. The more cash you have, the cheaper you can get your house. Besides, the cost of buying a home does not end with the purchase. It gives birth to many other spending gremlins like a new dining table, new stuff to make your living room look beautiful. In a year's time, you will have to spend quite a large amount of money for pipes, lighting, and paint, and many other things. Now, all of these expenses can cost quite a lot, giving your finances a huge jolt, further putting your investments at disarray. Renting now so that you can invest to buy a house will take longer. That's true. But here's my bold prediction. If you and your husband work hard at your careers, you will be able to buy that house in less than 15 years. And here's the strategy. Your salaries are bound to increase by 10% or so every year. And if you keep your lifestyle simple and invest that 10% increase, like the financial OC that I believe you are, and that's a compliment, you will be buying that house in no time. Filipinos love to buy houses. It's a status symbol. Let me call it like it is, because this is what it's all about, isn't it? But honey, I know you won't let yourself get sucked into this. Keep your eyes on the ball, because chances are the people who are pressuring you to buy that house don't have an education, a college fund, or a retirement fund like you do. So, who's wealthier now?
Still with us is SunLife AIM financial planner Early De Guzman and of course Melissa Hekuleo with your money questions. Mel, fascinating scenario,
yeah,
right?
I think it's a common problem. Yes. Actually. Yeah. I know people who haven't planned for their retirement mm-hmm. yet, so, and they should be. Anyway, mm-hmm. first question Go comes on. From Charlie via Facebook, who asks, I just said goodbye to my 20-year job at a big corporation, got all the severance pay and benefits that come with loyalty. But I'm only 45 and I have always wanted to put up my own coffee shop. The problem is I never got to create a retirement fund. Do I use the severance pay to start my new venture or make it grow a few years before pouring it into my cafe? And what investment tools should I consider?
All right. Good question.
Good question. Would be nice to know how much all that severance pay and benefits are.
To start
if
off
it's
with
a hefty amount,
yes.
And the cost to put up the coffee shop is within, say, 10 or 20% of what you're making, I'd say go. Mm-hmm. But the bigger question is, you really want to run a coffee shop? You know, I mean, just thinking of the food that you have to prepare and all mm-hmm. that, and the hours you have to keep. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think you have to take stock, more importantly, of your entrepreneurial mindset compared to how it was when you were
right.
an employee. You might be working harder than when you were in your 20-year job. Mm-hmm. Now, looking forward though, at 45, you're young. You could actually even envision another career, which means what I'm really saying is that those funds that you have are very good for investment. So create that other income stream. I mean, if you were to invest a good amount of that, it could be your coffee shop without your having to wake up early in the
right.
morning or put up with customers and staff. So that's
right.
another way to look at it. Now, in terms of sharing, I mean, looking at your portfolio, if you had 100%, like I said, maybe 10, 20 for a new venture, which means this is money you can burn.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm just doing a simple Pareto.
Sure, sure.
Formula.
Okay.
Now,
sense.
With the 80% you've got at 45, well, they said the rule of thumb in investment is 100 less your age. Mm-hmm. So at 45, 65 should be in more secure investment. Mm-hmm. So that's your bank account, that's your time deposit, mm-hmm. that's your guaranteed funds, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And with your 45, make a mix.
Mm-hmm.
You could be in mutual funds, but I'd say more heavily go into VUL because you have the added coverage and the estate tax protection.
If she has dependents, right?
Even as a single person. Yeah, if you had dependents, all the more.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to make provision for them.
First things first, talk about the emergency fund.
Yes.
He's got this money. He's not got a job anymore. He wants to go into mm-hmm. business. You want
yes.
to give advice on emergency funds.
Emergency
as
fund.
As a priority
personal
for him.
Well, even within the business, you have to not use up all the planned capital. And then when you're earning in the business, you have to set aside because you have to refurbish, mm-hmm. you have to reflow, etc. So looking back at emergency money, I think that goes for his personal life. Right?
Sure.
And we were saying something like at mm-hmm. least 3 to 6 months mm-hmm. of what he would need. But if he can, I mean, the investments he would make, like if I parked a single pay investment, mm-hmm. VUL, $1 million of, let's say, a $5 million severance pay,
mm-hmm.
that should be fairly good for him to work with. $1 million at 13.6% compounding could be a lot of money in 10 years, 20 years, in the time that he has.
Okay.
Okay, now Carmela asks, what is a good retirement fund formula? There are so many priorities to put ahead, education, health insurance. Is it selfish to have retirement as a priority?
I wish that we could say that all these have to come together and it's just a matter of cutting up the pie.
Right.
But more often than not, the reality is sometimes pretty much of what you have just goes into an immediate need like education or health because there is a condition mm-hmm. to be addressed. So given that that is not the situation I am being asked mm-hmm. and that you just want to kind of create a portfolio of investments to address those different needs, well, in terms of priority, you were asking, should I make retirement part of it? Definitely. When we talk about saving, the first person who gets paid is you. Mm-hmm. It's not what you typically, you know, like what people do in the way they save or they handle money. Mm-hmm. You have an inflow, let's say that's business income or your salary. You deduct the expenses and then hopefully there's something left. And that's when you save. That's the typical notion.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I think that needs some changing.
That needs to be changed. Mm-hmm.
You should work up, this is what I'm earning. Here's the amount I want to set aside.
Right, so pay yourself first.
And pay yourself first. Mm-hmm. And it should be the same. That should work out for the retirement.
Yeah. Early, but I think what she's asking is, she has limited pie, as you were trying to explain earlier, and she has to choose whether it's retirement or education or health insurance.
Okay. So now I go to the prioritization.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. I would always, well, first you have to protect yourself because mm-hmm. you are the
insurance.
Income earning. Health insurance would probably be the first. I'm presuming there's already a life protection plan here.
Right.
And then, of course, education. Your retirement should come in up front. The 5 or 10% that you're willing to set aside, because that can cover both life, health, and education. So when you ask the question, is it selfish to have retirement as a priority? No, because by addressing that retirement fund you're actually creating a fund to meet the other priorities like education, health, and life.
Now Zenaida asks, my daughter supports me because I never really worked as my husband always supported the whole family while he was alive. I want to try and help out with something, but I am 61 years old. Is there anything I can do to help my daughter out and maybe even build up a fund for her to pay her back for supporting me for the past decade?
Interesting and very commendable mom, you know. I'd answer that question in many ways. There's always a way to be able to give back and express that gratitude mm-hmm. or even, you know, repay. Although I didn't like to really say repay mm-hmm. because I don't think your daughter did that with the end in view of collecting.
Correct.
Right.
So this is really more.
Per se.
This is more out of your love and your appreciation for mm-hmm. what's happened. Let's look at your asset base. What have you got that you can give and invest or position so that it can create something you can give back to her? Mm-hmm. You have properties, you have a ring, you have a car. I mean, that's first line.
That's good advice.
Now,
mm-hmm.
Number two, you have money. Maybe, okay, let's look at the extreme. You don't have anything, no assets, no money. How would I? You have yourself. Mm-hmm. You want to go into a new business. You want to be the, you know, you could do a daycare, let the kids
take
stay
care
with
of the
you.
Apples, yeah.
Take
right,
care
yeah.
of the apples mm-hmm. of your neighbor, mm-hmm. of the classmates of your mm-hmm. daughter's children. Mm-hmm. Or you can cook. Look at what you're blessed with.
Your skill sets. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Your skill sets, your opportunities, and then take it from there. Then make that a cash stream in some form. And maybe I'd also say, maybe she's not after cash. Maybe the fact that you're free to, you know, manage the household for her is a big blessing, and that's a way of appreciation.
Send us your money questions via email, Facebook, or through Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Right, so 50s, no retirement, where there's a will,
there's a way.
I think that's
And I think one last point, if you can't afford it, you don't need it.
There you go.
Work on buying something you need.
Excellent.
And buy things that increase with value rather than those that decrease in
Well
time.
Said, Early. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mel, that's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talking tips so you're always right on the money.